Hello everyone, this is a video continues from the previous part of this series on damage feedback system. If you haven't watched the previous part, feel free to check it out. In this video, I will be going through how to create a floating text like in Vampire Survivors in Unity. In Vampire Survivors, when an enemy takes damage, there will be a floating text panning upwards and fades away over time, representing damage dealt to the enemies. To achieve this effect in Unity, we'll be spawning a text mesh pro text at the enemy's position. After spawning it, we'll pan the text upwards and fade it away. In our approach, everything is handled within script. You don't have to create any new prefab for it. Now let's dive into the scripts. In the game manager script, we have introduced 4 new public variables. A canvas variable called damage text canvas, a float named text font size, a TMP font asset called text font, and a camera named reference camera. Damage text canvas contains the canvas we'll be drawing our damage text on using code, while text font size will be the variable we adjust to increase or decrease the font size of the spawn text. Text font is a variable we can assign a font to if we want to use a different font from the default one that Text Mesh Pro comes with, which I will cover how to use later in the video. Finally, reference camera is the camera we'll be using to convert world coordinates to screen coordinates, so we know where on the canvas we should be spawning the damage text. In the script, we have created a new static function called generateFloatingText, which is designed to make floating text appear whenever it is called. The function is made static so that we can access the function by calling gameManager.generateFloatingText instead of having to call gameManager.instance.generateFloatingText to access the function. If you are still not clear on what the static property does, you can check out the article we have on our blog to clear things up. We also created a new coroutine function called generateFloatingTextCoroutine. This function is the one that will be responsible for the animation of our floating text after it is spawned. It is not meant to be called directly by other scripts, which is why it is private. The coroutine is called by the game manager itself when you call gameManager.generateFloatingText from another script. Both functions take in the same parameters, a string called text, which is the text that will be popping up, a transform called target, which refers to the transform of the enemy, two optional parameters called duration and speed, which handle the speed of the text fading away. So here's how it works. GenerateFloatingText function will be called by other scripts. In the function, we will check if DamageTextCanvas variable is set. If the variable is not set, the function will be stopped. This is to prevent errors from arising as we need the DamageTextCanvas to be set in order for the function to work. Then we will check if ReferenceCamera is set. If it is not set, we will set it to Camera.main, which is the primary camera in the scene. This line of code is not necessary, but it will make our function work even if a reference camera is not assigned. Once reference camera is set, we start the generate floating text coroutine and pass in the parameters that are passed into the function. In the coroutine, we'll be creating and destroying a canvas game object using code. To determine what components our game object needs, we can first create a sample game object on the canvas to test it out. We want our game object to be on a canvas of our choice, and the game object should have two components, a rect transform and a text mesh pro text component. Note that by adding a rect transform component on our game object, the default transform component that game objects come with will be automatically replaced. In our code, we also keep a reference to both the rect transform and text mesh pro text component as we will be modifying their attributes. We also want to set our text to the assigned string and our text to be centered horizontally and vertically. We also set the font size to the parameters in the game manager, and set a different font to be used by our newly created game object if it is assigned to the game manager. Then, we'll modify the position of the rect transform of our game object so that it appears on top of the target. When we are calling the function later, the enemy's transform will be passed in as the target argument, but we cannot just assign this transform to our floating text. This is because the enemy's position is in world space, but our UI element is in screen space. So what we need to do here is to use our reference camera, which allows us to access the world to screen point function to convert the world space position to screen space position so that the position of the floating text on the canvas will be right on top of the enemy. Following this, we will call the destroy function with a second float parameter so that the spawn game object will be destroyed after a short delay, equivalent to what we set the duration of the floating text to. Lastly, we will parent it to the damage text canvas so that our game object will show up in game. Before I forget, head over to animate.script and call the function here. We will only call the function if damage is more than 0. Don't forget to assign the damage text canvas in the inspector. Up to this point, if you call this function, floating text will appear on a GIMP object of your choice, but it will not animate. Now let's implement the animation of our floating text. In this coroutine, we'll be smoothly panning the floating text upwards and transitioning the alpha value of the text from 1 to 0, which means that it will need to fire every frame. To achieve that, we'll be using a while loop that will run once every single frame. First, we create a new wait for end of frame object called W, which we'll be using to introduce the single frame delay every time the while loop fires. We'll also create two new local floats called T and Y offset respectively. T will track how long the coroutine has been running, as it will be incremented every time the while loop runs, and serve as the exit condition of the while loop once it has been running longer than our set duration. The Y offset value will be used to track where our text should be at any given frame, and because the text is supposed to float upwards, it will be incremented every frame and added to the original screen position of our floating text. Finally, in our code, we'll also reduce the alpha value of the code at every frame using a formula. This is the same formula that we used in our part 13 video, so check that video out for an explanation. With that, we should have the floating text working. Before I end the video, let me show you how we can modify the font and font size of the floating text. So usually when you download a font, you will get either TFF or OTF file. Import them into the project. Then, you will need to convert the files into a TMP font asset. Go over to Windows, Text Mesh Pro, Font Asset Creator. Select the files and click on Generate Font Atlas. Then, save it in the project. Once done, you just need to drag the TMP font asset into the text font parameter under Game Manager. As you can see here, the font has been changed. If you modify the text font size variable, the font size of the floating text should be changing accordingly. And that's it for this video. If it helps, we also have an accompanying article available to all Bronze Patreons, as well as a download link for the project files for Silver Patreons available in the video description below. If you would like to see more code explanation about the floating text, you can also click on the link on the corner of this video to go directly to the part of the coding stream where the code was created. Want to support what we do? You can help us by becoming a patron. This will give you access to the project files for our tutorials, as well as patron exclusive posts on our blog. Any support you can give will go a long way. Currently, we are making back about 20 cents back for every dollar we put into content creation. So your help will go a long way to help us make this a sustainable endeavor. See you in the next video.